This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
We come together as the people of God to praise our Lord and King, to encourage each other as we seek perfection in love and faith and righteousness, to sing and laugh and revel in all the blessings that God lavishes upon us, and to find rest in the arms of Jesus. This is Christ the King Sunday. We honor Christ as one with the Father and the Holy Spirit, as the supreme ruler of all that is, in this age and in the age to come. Our hymn of praise, He Has Made Us Glad, it's on the screen. Let's stand and sing.
Provide for our wants to be so.
join in this historic confession of our faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us join in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church.
We have not done your will.
We have broken your law.
We have rebelled against your love.
We have not loved our neighbors,
and we have not heard the cry of the needy.
Forgive us, we pray.
Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
As a forgiven people and reconciled, let us stand and give each other signs of reconciliation and peace.
Blessings to you.
Our next hymn is on the screen, Forever. The name of the song is Forever. Never mind. I didn't cut it out quite right. Okay, let's stand and sing.
Sing praise.
set aside, that our nation has set aside since the Civil War, to give thanks for the bounty that God has given us and all the good things that we receive from our God and King. But it's also a day that we should remember the gift that God has given us of other people, and to give thanks to them for the goodness they've shown us, the kindness they've shown us, the support they've shown us, our parents, our families, our friends. It's a day to be thankful for all these, because companionship and love is also a gift from God. And so it's a day that the thankfulness should prevail, like I said, for God and for the gift that, for other people. Now, the silly song that I've been singing for the kids, I've gotten to the point where I'm actually going to repeat one, which means that I've had 36 different songs over this year, and so I got to expand my repertoire, but I think that's pretty good with 36 songs repeating one. So it's a song of thankfulness.
If I were a butterfly, I'd thank you, Lord, for giving me wings. And if I were a robin in a tree, I'd thank you, Lord, that I could sing. And if I were a fish in the sea, I'd wiggle my tail and I'd giggle with glee. But I'd just thank you, Father, for making me be. Because you gave me a heart.
Despite what's been thrown at us, we have met the challenges and continue to faithfully proclaim the Word of God and make disciples of all nations. We want to thank you for your prayers. We'd like to thank you for your money. We'd like to thank you for your time and the service that you've done in the work of Christ through this church. So let us pray. Almighty God, giver of all good and perfect gifts, we thank you for the blessing upon blessing you lavish so generously upon us. Give us generous hearts, and the resources that you've trusted to us may be used to build your kingdom upon this earth. Amen.
Thank you. Perfect earlier.
Yeah, this is why I got out of computers. Oh well, this is Christ the King Sunday, and Christ the King Sunday is the last Sunday of the liturgical year, the fiscal year Church. And it's fitting that we end the year just before Advent. Advent starts next Sunday. And of course, Advent is when we're anticipating the birth of Christ, the coming of Emmanuel, God with us. And we end the year with God the King in his heavenly kingdom, on his throne. And so the kingship of Christ. We look, of course, at the day that he will reign, and we'll see him face to face in his glory in the heavenly realm. But the kingdom of Christ is also a present reality. It's one of those mysteries of the faith that Paul talked about. It's the not yet, but already here of the kingdom of God. Now, the thing about kingship and monarchies and all this is that it's not something that we Americans really have much of a grasp of. After all, in 1776, we kind of rejected the idea of a monarch and a king. But even in 1776, when we were revolting against King George III, the British monarchy was a little bit different than a lot of the other monarchies, in that the British monarchy was also a limited monarchy. The king did not have absolute power. The Magna Carta in 1215 kind of limited the power of the king, which was a little bit more unusual. If you want to look at modern monarchies today, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and the Kingdom of Kuwait are true monarchies. Queen Elizabeth, of course, is still in this limited monarchy that's becoming increasingly limited as Parliament has grown in power. But we just don't really understand or think of kings the same way that the Old Testament writers or the biblical or the New Testament people really had as their idea of a king. The idea of an absolute monarchy and the kingships that they were used to is the idea of the king owned the country. He owned everything. The land was his, the cattle was his, the livestock was his, the people were his. And he actually physically was the owner of everything. Now, we remember Jesus one time, he was asked about paying taxes to Caesar. This is recorded in Mark 12. And the Levitical priests, they bring a coin, they go to Jesus and ask, is it all right to pay, is it lawful in the Torah to pay taxes to Caesar? And if you remember, what Jesus said was, well, bring me a coin, show me a coin. They showed him a denarius. Whose picture is that? That's Caesar's picture. And what did Jesus say? Well, if it's Caesar's, give it back to Caesar. And that was kind of the idea, that the money belonged to Caesar. The wealth of the empire belonged to Caesar. We see again the story of Esther in the Old Testament. Esther was part of that captivity, of the Babylonian captivity. Except by this time it was in Babylon, the Xerxes and the Persian Empire had conquered the Babylonian Empire. So King Xerxes, he had a falling out with his queen, King Vashti. And so he decided, or his advisor said, well, just have a beauty contest among all the eligible women in the kingdom. And so that's what he did. He said, okay, after all, the king owns people. And so they gathered all the eligible women, including Esther, and they gave her they gave all these women 6 months of perfume treatment and 6 months of makeup, and then they had this beauty contest. Now, of course, one of the things in my sports sense of humor, I look in the Bible and I think, 6 months of perfume and 6 months of cosmetics. How ugly were these women? And how bad did they smell? But King Xerxes can do this because he owned the kingdom, he owned the people, he owned the land, he owned everything. Now Israel was a little bit different because in the monarchy of Israel, the king was limited. The king was not the priest. The priesthood were the Levites. The kings were from the tribe of Benjamin. There were two different tribes. And there were certain things that the king could not do because that was what the priest did. That's why Saul got in trouble as the first king. He did the sacrifice. He wasn't supposed to do the sacrifice. Samuel was supposed to do the sacrifice. And that's why the kingdom was taken away from him. The idea of this Torah, this law of Moses, superseded the king. The king had to obey the Torah. He had to live under the law of God, which was unusual. This is one of the problems that King Ahab ran into with Jezebel, and why the people of Israel didn't like Jezebel very much. She wasn't from Israel. She didn't understand that the king was limited. There's a story in 1 Kings chapter 21 where there's this vineyard owned by Naboth. And King Ahab really wanted that vineyard. And Naboth wouldn't sell it to him. And Jezebel didn't understand this. She's like, you're the king. Just take it. Naboth said, that's not the way we do things around here. Well, Jezebel raged the rage to have Naboth knocked off. And so this is one of the things that was so unpopular and so much created such tension with Jezebel. Now, God never really intended for Israel to have a king at all. After all, God was king. And this is one of the things that struck the Israeli people when they asked for a king. Notice that Moses was not ordained as a king. Abraham was not ordained as a king. Joshua, who conquered the land, he was not ordained as a king. After the conquest of Israel, for 350 years, that's a long time, 350 years, then Israel did not have a king. It was ruled by judges, by Deborah, by Gideon, by all these judges of Israel, by Samson. And Samuel was the last king. But people being people, humans being the weak creatures that we are, looked around and they saw, well, everybody else has a king. There's Pharaoh down in Egypt. He's a king. There's, the Syrians have a king. The Phoenicians have a king. The Philistines have a king. We need a king to be like other countries. Never a good excuse to be just like somebody else. I mean, how many times did we tell our children, if they were jumping off a cliff, if your friends were jumping off a cliff, would you jump off a cliff too? But that's the argument they use. Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 8, starting in verse 7. The Lord said to them, listen to the people and what they're selling to you. They have not rejected you, but they have rejected me. As they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are doing to you, and listen to them. But warn them, and let them know what a king will do when he reigns over you and demands his rights. And so Samuel does warn them. He says, first of all, your sons will be drafted for labor to do public works projects, the things that the king wants done, building the palace, building the roads. Your daughters will be drafted as bakers and perfumers to serve the royal court. They'll be drafted into a standing army. We'll have a standing army that will be engaged in conquest. And there will be court officials. There will be bureaucrats. More bureaucrats. When they're done, more bureaucrats. And the king will charge taxes of 10% right off the top. How many of you would like taxes just to be 10%? That's the biblical standard, 10%. And so Samuel ordained Saul and David. And these were good kings. And then Israel did have several good kings. David, Solomon, Hezekiah. The Bible speaks very high of Jehoshaphat. But far more of them were bad kings. And the one queen. They were human. Subject to all that we are and all the faults and failures that humans have. Christ comes as the good king. We think of God as Christ as the good shepherd, but then you also think about the good king. And the first thing that a good king does is he provides for his people. We look around at creation. We look around all this beauty and bounty. All that we've been given to satisfy our physical needs. This earth produces, this creation where we have been set, this garden. God's garden, it's still God's garden. But this garden in which we've been set has all the things we need. Astronaut Michael Collins, Buzz Armstrong. Had this, when he was in space, he looked at Earth out the window and he said, it struck him that every human that ever lived was on that small blue planet. And he and Neil Armstrong and Michael Collins were the only ones. that we make come from the minerals and the rocks and the plants that we have. The fancy phones that we carry in our pockets are from the minerals that God provided for us, not by we ourselves. A king, a good king, gives to his people. A good king, God gives not only to our physical needs, but also the things that make life worth living, music and art, curiosity, laughter. Those things that lift our spirits and make life more than something, a venture in simple survival. All those things that we enjoy doing and living and sharing, all provided by the hands of our good King, our loving God. A good King who gives us free will, a choice of how to live our life and the things that we choose to do. Now, he guides us, he tries to steer us, but he also gives us that opportunity to sometimes make mistakes, but sometimes to grow and to learn. A good king gives his people freedom. It is a good king who leads his people in peace, to live in harmony. We all want our children to get along with each other. Now, my son was an only child. When he was 5 years old, his niece, he was the first born on both sides of the family. So he had, well, let's put it that way. His niece was born 5 years later and offered some competition. And so they had some spats. But we want our kids, we want our children, our nieces, nephews, cousins, all get along with each other. And that's what God gives us. God gives us his loving guidance in the Torah, in those laws that are not there so he can say, if we step out of line, he's going to zap us. That's not the point. But this loving guidance of a loving God that says, you know what? If you live this way, you're really going to have a better life. If you live this way, you're really going to enjoy life a lot more. If you live this way, you're going to get along with your neighbors. You're going to be able to have fun, laughter, and all those good things. The loving guidance of a loving God. The King who gave us prophets over time to correct us, to keep us back in line, to teach us what we need to clarify when we get confused, to keep us back on track. All those messengers that he sent, and all those messages that he sent, as he speaks through people, to get us back to where we need to be when we've gone astray, when we've stepped out of line. Because he still speaks to you, too. And he still speaks to the people around you. And we, together as a community of faith, correct each other and help each other along this way as we're trying to figure out. Life's a lot of on-the-job training. And we make mistakes and we need each other. It's a king who leads his people in peace and tranquility. Our God is a good king who balances justice and mercy. There is a standard of righteousness. There is right and there is wrong. There is good and there is evil. And these things are defined by God. We tend to try to define them ourselves, but that's not who defines good and evil, or right or wrong. There are things that are simply not the right thing to do. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill. We know these things. And these rules are there because they are right and wrong. They lead us into righteousness. And part of what we strive to live is to live righteous lives. Not so that we can, feel superior to other people, but because there's that, in the word satisfaction, that there's in that inward comfort when we know that this is good and this is decent and this is right. It helps us find that joy. So he sets those standards of righteousness and that justice, that balance, the and scales. But he's also a God who came down and knows that exactly what kind of people we are. He knows how hard it is to be human, and he knows that sometimes even the best of us have bad days. He's a God of forgiveness, a God of mercy. When we're truly sorry and we know that we've gone astray, and sometimes, you know, shame and guilt are also a gift of God, and sometimes we need them to get us back on track. Don't wallow in shame. Don't wallow in guilt. But if it hits you that you need to change and get better, there's nothing. That's why it's a gift from God. And God forgives us when we repent, when we turn around. It's like the story of the prodigal son. The younger son takes his inheritance and goes to a far-off country and wastes all that he has. And finally realizes that he's not happy. Finally realizes that he's done wrong. Finally feels that guilt and shame. Says, I will go back to my father's house. And his father's waiting for him with open arms, looking down the road to welcome him back. Because God loves us. God is a good king who teaches his people. The rabbi who explains what he means. That understands that sometimes we're a little dense. Sometimes it takes us a while to catch up. You know, there's a saying that in publicity, when we're working on the internet, building the internet, you have to tell somebody seven times before they hear it once. There's some people you have to tell 14 times this morning. But it's a rabbi who explains, think of the stories that God told us, these parables from Jesus. These stories that have all these layers upon layers to help us understand what God means, what it really means to love, what it really means to be good, what it really means to be righteous. The story of the prodigal son, what it means to be the son who wandered off into a far country and squandered what he had, and the feelings and the emotions we get when we go astray. The position of the righteous son, the one who stayed, who was obedient, who did what his father asked, who worked hard. And sees the son come home and his brother come home, and he really isn't happy that he's getting a fatty cat. Sometimes we do that. Sometimes we feel we're superior because we're here at church. Not like those. That's not love. And that's part of the story too. And sometimes we've been in the position of the father, just wanting whatever happened for someone that we love and care about just to come home, just to get back on track, just to be reconciled with them. And of course, we always read that parable with the father in the story being the God himself who reconciles us. But sometimes we're not in our position. That's what's great about these stories, is they teach us so much on level upon level every time we read them. Good king is a king who teaches his people. A good king is a king who defends his people. Throughout my life, I've seen too many things that are just to explain as coincidences. Too many things that just to write off as, well, that was lucky. No, God watches over each one of us. I have seen your. And if you really think about it, you have to. There's been times when good things should have gone really, really far south, and they just didn't. Is God looking up for us when we were foolish? God looking out for us when we needed. I've seen people that have had bad diagnoses healed. God, a great physician, healing us. And of course, I know that many people will just explain it as, well, miracles, and well, if you're just attributing it to God. No, I believe it's God's name. For me, being here, when I first thought I was going to be in Junction, it's like, I don't know. when I was being going through the interviews of being a pastor, they were saying, appointments, and that when you become a pastor, you're going to be appointed by the bishop for every sentence. And I said, and that may be a remote area. I'm like, well, I'm going to El Paso, that's kind of way off in the end. It's 200 miles from nothing, from all that. And one of the pastors who was the senior pastor said, he pretended to write down, doesn't mind being in the middle of nowhere. But after this year, I'm glad I'm here. And not in San Antonio. And I believe that was God looking out for me. A king that defends his people. And giving me the opportunity to do things that I don't know that I could have done if I was still in San Antonio. But to continue to preach and do this thing that God has called me to do, God's been looking out for me. A king, a good king, is a king who knows he's one of his people. Christ emptied himself of all that glory, of all that honor of heaven, to become one of us. God is not a God who sits in heaven or sits on Mount Olympus directing his little subjects, his little playthings on the earth. God came to be with us and walk our journey. He knew what it was like to be hungry. He knew what it was like to have friends and have friends betray him. He knew what it was like to have a friend die. He knew what it was like to be unjustly accused. He knew what it was like to walk miles and miles and miles in the hot summer sun. Remember, we're all basically the same latitude here as Jerusalem, basically. So, the climate is pretty much the same. So, we're just as far from the North Pole as we are. We know what it's like. He knew what it was like. He was a king who endures with his people, who feels everything that you feel. Feels joy when you feel joy, feels sadness and sorrow and loneliness, and pain when you feel sadness and sorrow and loneliness and pain. Who walked the journey of life. He's a king who set an example. Who came down and not just told us how to love people, but we could see through his life how he showed compassion. How he dealt with people. How he loved those around him. How he healed the sick and comforted those that were lonely. When a man came frustrated and said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. When a centurion, one of the enemy, comes and says, I need you to heal my servant. When a man, the chief rabbi, loses his daughter and he goes with him right then. And in the midst of going, a woman touches his robe and is healed. And he pauses for this woman. And he says, your sins are forgiven, be healed, your faith is made too strong. Taking the time to be with those people. Taking the time to walk their journey. Taking the time, setting that example of how we are to live our lives and the relationships that we have with those around us. Our friends, our family, and even strangers. He's the king who's one of us. And of course, he's the king who sacrifices himself for his people. Who suffers a mortal death on a cross. A torturous death. One of the most horrendous deaths ever devised by the mind of man. And yet he still has the power to go through that sacrifice of himself for his people. Forgive them, Father. For they don't know what they do. He's a king who's all in for his subjects. I've told you the joke before about bacon and eggs. The chicken makes a contribution, the pig is all in. God is all in for us. And for this, we respond to this King. This King of the universe, the one who sits in majesty and awe. And we worship that majesty and we worship that power. We worship and praise His goodness and His gifts and His love that He shows for us. We praise Him for His involvement in our lives, each and every one of us, because He loves you that much. We respond by obeying, by listening to His word, by striving for that holiness, by striving for that perfection, for trying to be the people that He created us to be, because that's what's going to bring us that satisfaction, that true peace and that true joy in our soul, that deep, deep joy that goes just beyond laughter and the momentary pleasure. For this we respond in confession. Going before God when we messed up and just saying, you know, I messed up. I did not handle that well. I did not be the person you wanted me to be. I let the situation get the best of me. I responded in the way that I know I shouldn't. Going before Him in humility. Because none of us are as good as we think we are. None of us are as smart as we think we are. And none of us know all that there is to know to make the good decisions that God guides us into. God knows how hard it is to do. And as messed up as we are, He loves us anyway. And of course, we go in gratitude. We go in thankfulness. We go because God showers upon us this blessing upon blessing, far more than we understand, far more than we comprehend, far more than we're even aware of. The good things that God gives us, the good things that God has provided for us. And we respond in thanksgiving. We give Him thanks for who He is. It is good that this week we set aside time as a nation to give thanks to God for all the good things that are here. And even if it was a bad time, it was a bad thing, to give thanks anyway. Because God loves us and cares for us and wants us to succeed and wants us to be His people. He wants us to enjoy life. It's a gift that He's given us. And we thank Him for everything. Thank Him for the people that He's given us to show us love, to bring us to. All these things. Almighty God, we thank You from the bottom of our hearts for all that You've given us, for all that You've showered upon us. We thank You for being our good team. Are we going to try again or not? No, okay. All right. So, our hymn of reflection, you may remain seated as we sing, "Surely the Presence," we can sing it twice through. We stand in awe of Your power and of your majesty. Upon the glory that our mortal eyes just cannot behold, we worship you and praise you and honor you. For you alone are holy. You rule with justice. You rule with mercy and compassion. We are your humble servants. We fall before your feet. We thank you for all the good things that you've given us. More than we can imagine, far beyond measure. We thank you for all the things that make life joyful. And we thank you for being there and showing us compassion and showing us being your presence, even when things aren't going so well. Open our eyes, Lord. Give us our hearts and of joy. Give us spirits that are lifted up in praise and thanksgiving. Clear away all those things that occupy our mind, those evil thoughts that keep us from loving one another. Change our focus onto from the negative onto those positive things. Give us an attitude of gratitude, an attitude of joy, to look for the blessing and look for your gift and look for your presence. All around us, in everything that we see and all that we do. We thank you for the body of Christ and community of believers that surround us. Our fellow pilgrims that are on this journey. We thank you for the love and support that they've given us. And we thank you for the opportunity to serve them and help them along their way. Grant us your wisdom. Grant us your heart. Clear away our pride. Clear away our selfishness. Clear away our anger, our greed, our lust, all those things that create those walls that divide us, your children, from one another. Help us to be the people that you have called us to be. Lord, we do come before you with those things that are heavy on our heart and mind. We pray for those who are suffering from the disease that is affecting our world. We are anxious regarding the rise in the number of cases. We ask for your healing presence on those that are suffering from this ailment. We ask that you grant peace and perseverance to the medical personnel that are addressing the situation, that are trying to keep us healthy and keep us safe. Be with them and their families through this hard time. Almighty God, we ask you for the healing of relationships. We ask you for the healing of our nation. We ask you to guide us to be reconciled one to another, that we may live together in domestic tranquility. Lord, we ask you for a renewed commitment to truth, a renewed commitment to justice. We ask you for a renewed commitment to cooperation, that this nation may truly be one nation under God. We ask you to enlighten the souls, the minds of all those around us. We ask for wisdom for our leaders, that they may govern your people in justice and in peace and all the blessings that this land has for us. We ask for the refreshing of rain upon this earth, this land that's grown dry. We need you to refresh and renew the life. We thank you for this season, the season of Advent that's coming up. We thank you for your guidance through this year, that you have brought us to where we are. Help us to be the people that you've created us to be. And we thank you for the gift of your Son, our Rabbi, our example, and our King, our good King, the one who taught us all to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Is there anyone that today that has a special blessing, a birthday, an anniversary they'd like to celebrate, either a good celebration or joy? Or is there any concern that you'd like to lift up before the congregation? We, of course, pray for Sarah Harrison, who's such an important part of this church. How's she doing, Larry?
She's good. She's here for me and came walk through
our energy. So low on energy, but she went through her treatments well?
Both surgeries were very successful.
All right. Almighty God, we thank you for your healing touch, O great physician, upon Sarah, and that the surgeries went well. We ask that you restore her strength, that she may continue to serve you as she has so faithfully done. We thank you for the heart that you've given her for you. Grant her all the blessings upon blessings, the joy upon joys, the love upon love that you have for her, and the good work that she's done in your name. Be with Larry as well as he nurses her back to health and helps her to regain strength. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Dawn. Robert Fox. Almighty God, we ask you for the blessing upon Robert Fox and his family as he prepares to see you face to face. Accept into your arms this sinner of your own redeeming, this sheep of your own flock. Grant comfort to the family as their loved one departs. Give them that blessed assurance that you are with them, and that you still love and look after all of them. In this great mystery that we don't know of what is to come, and the anxiety and the fear that brings, we ask that this be a peaceful transition, and that you give comfort to the family as they go through their loss. Amen. Lord, we lift up the Smith family and the health issues that they face, Alice and Johnny and the two children as they face whatever ailments that they have. We ask for your peace. We ask for your healing, O great physician. We thank you for the commitment this family has made toward you and making disciples of all nations. Bless them and be with them now and forevermore. Margaret Day. Almighty God, we lift before you Margaret Day and the diagnosis with breast cancer. We ask for your healing touch, O great physician. We ask for you grant your peace, and we know that this brings great anxiety and great fear. We ask that you bring comfort to her. Guide the physicians that they may find the best treatment for her, that she may be restored to health and continue to serve and love you and enjoy this beautiful life that you've given. We ask in your name. Amen. Anyone else? Our closing hymn is Now Thank Thee, All Our God, number 102. Let's stand and sing. Give you peace. Amen.